Hello, class. In this video, we will start to look at dynamics, which means looking at the forces leading to the motions that we studied in our kinematics unit. As with the kinematics unit, I won't cover every aspect covered in your reading assignment, but instead we'll focus on some examples and common trouble spots. So let's start here with some of the common forces and notations that you will see. Here we have the force of gravity, and another notation that you might see for this is the weight. And you'll notice that everything here is a vector quantity. So it's often seen as either a typeface in bold or with the added vector on top. We also have the normal force from contact between two surfaces, Fn, or sometimes some sources will use a capital N. We have the friction between two surfaces, so the frictional force, or sometimes a lowercase f on its own. And we have the tension along a rope or a similar connection between objects. One of our primary tools for analyzing force problems is the free body diagram. This enables us to determine the resultant or net force on an object, which determines its motion. For example, determining if it moves with constant velocity or constant acceleration. So let's look at some examples. Here is a man pulling a crate with a rope. Let's look specifically at the forces on the crate. The person is applying a force via the tension of the rope. The weight of the crate, due to the force of gravity, acts downwards. The surface of the floor is providing an upward normal force that supports the crate. I'll just show it at one point of contact here, but it applies for the object as a whole. And finally, because the crate is in contact with the floor, there's a friction between the surfaces. And this friction is in the opposite direction to any possible motion, or it impedes any motion. For the free body diagram, we show these forces acting on a single point. So as if all the mass is concentrated at that one point, say the center of mass, which you'll see introduced in Unit 5 when dealing with rotational motion. And so we've got the tension to the left, the normal force acting upward, gravity acting downward, and the frictional force acting to the left or impeding that motion that we are trying to create with the tension. The second example recognizes that we'll need to consider forces as vectors and look at the perpendicular components. So let's define our x and y axes. We've got our positive x in that direction and our positive y in that direction. Again, we have the force of gravity, which is always a good place to start. Along with a normal or perpendicular force due to contact with the floor. And the force of friction opposing the motion. And finally, we have this applied force at an angle theta relative to the horizontal or positive x-axis. On the free body diagram, then, that looks like this. We've got the force of gravity acting downward. We don't always need to do these to scale. We're just trying to get an idea of balancing them out and breaking them down into their components. Got a normal force upward here. We've got a frictional force acting in the impeding direction. And we've got the two components, Fx and Fy. Pardon me. I like to show this one as a dotted because it's really acting here at our point here. And so that is the component of this F, or applied force, that we have. So we've got an Fy and an Fx component to that force, where we've got an angle there, theta. And so this Fx is going to be an F cos theta, and our Fy that I showed in the middle is going to be equal to an F sine theta. And so it really is applied over here, but it's often useful just to dot it out over here where we can access it and we can label it. And it also helps us then with figuring out our coses and our sines, because it's opposite of that theta. Here's an applied version of that. A toboggan is being pulled along a horizontal snow-covered field by a person exerting a force of 72 newtons horizontally. In the opposite direction, there is a horizontal friction force on the toboggan of magnitude 69 newtons. The force of gravity on the toboggan is 153 newtons in magnitude, and the normal force exerted by the snow on the toboggan has a magnitude of 153 newtons. Determine the magnitude and direction of the resultant force on the toboggan. So we've got an applied force here trying to pull the toboggan of 72 newtons. To the right, I'm going to make this my positive x and this my positive y. In the opposite direction, there's a frictional force of 69 newtons. The force of gravity on the toboggan is 153 newtons, straight down. And the normal force exerted by the snow upward has a magnitude of 153 also. And so to determine the magnitude and direction of the resultant force on the toboggan, we're just adding up those components. There's no angles here, so rather simply, we can look at our Fx components and we can look at our Fy components. In the x direction, we've got a positive F equal to 72 newtons, and we've got a negative Ff, or frictional force, so a negative 69 newtons. In the y directions, we've got a positive Fn, so a positive 153 newtons, and we've got a negative Fg, or a negative 153 newtons. And so over here, you'll notice that I showed the magnitude along with the direction based on the vector that I was showing. And now on the right, I've included the direction and the magnitude as I lay these out. And so my net force, or my resultant force, will have a y component that is zero. And the x components have a resultant of 3 newtons, a positive 3 newtons, that is to the right. And so if I have no y component, then my resultant vector only has an x component, and my net force is going to be a positive 3 newtons to the right.